Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school and not a church, and neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious, and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh or Elohim and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity until this present day. This school was established as a result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year of 1931. We were incorporated into the state of California in the year of 1958. Since that time, we have established branch schools throughout the United States and Canada in certain foreign countries. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. Now, in this school, we teach by the true and correct names and title for the Father, the Word, our Son, and the Holy Spirit, as contained in the original Hebrew text. The true and correct name for the Father is Yahweh, and it has been erroneously substituted by Lord. The true and correct for the Word, our Son, is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit, manifest in or out of a physical body, is Yahshua. It has been improperly substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8:5 that they're Lord's many and God's many. But we now know each Lord must have a name and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means Elohim is a title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia will prove that neither the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin language have any letters or characters in their alphabet that would produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and correct name of our Father and his Son. Christ is a title just like Lord and God. Now Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state he is inscrutable and incomprehensible and indiscernible. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of all things. We have Yahweh in his pure spirit state, symbolized on this chart as a fiery cloud. Yahweh in pure spirit is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself, because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. Just as you see this fiery cloud, it's been drawn to its skin all around the edges of this chart, to show you that everything on this chart abides within this cloud. And like matter, everything in the creation and the sum total of the universe abides within this pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man cannot perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and form within himself as Elohim. This is the Word, our Son, a super incorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. This form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelation. Later on, this selfsame spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now there's only one name given unto salvation, and we must know that name. So the simple yet intelligent question we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface to the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called a divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of Egypt, he called Moses atop Mount Sinai and showed him the tabernacle pattern in a vision. He instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court roundabout. These three compartments make up your one tabernacle pattern. We go forth in this school to show proof how that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. The primary constitutional aims and objectives of the Institute are as follows. First, is to help you find and know Yahweh our Elohim as he really is and actually exists. Second, is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah, without distinction of race or nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third, is to investigate the unexplained spirit law or the so-called laws of nature and the powers latent in man. Fourth, is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. Fifth, to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth, to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seven, is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons, operating a mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Eight, is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith, which was once delivered unto the sons or children of Yahweh. Ninth, is to make known that Yahweh, from the beginning, ordained. There is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, save in the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth, is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in a new earth state. Our watchword is peace, and our slogan is speak the truth. We have a prayer this morning by Dr. Lloyd Lawless and a scripture lesson of 1 Corinthians, the 13th chapter, by Dr. Kenaway Clyde.
Good morning, class. Let us all bow our hearts and mind in prayer. Heavenly Father Yahweh, thank you once again for allowing us to enter into this glorious teaching and to encourage others to come and join the same bond of faith that we have in this teaching, because we know that it is a learning process, and we know that knowledge and wisdom shall be and is, see, the stability of our times, thank you, and the strength of our salvation. All these things we ask you in your only begotten Son's name, Yahshua Messiah, let us all say.
Hallelujah.
I'll be reading from the Holy Name Bible, reprinted by Yashua Promotions. 1 Corinthians 13. Though I speak with the tongues of men and angels and have not love, I am become a sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith, so that I could remove mountains and have not love, I am nothing. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned and have not love, it profiteth me nothing. Love suffereth long and is kind. Love envieth not. Love vaunteth not itself, is not puffed up. Does not behave itself unbecomingly, seeking not her own, is not easily provoked, thinketh no evil, rejoices not in iniquity, but rejoices in the truth, beareth all things, believeth all things, hopeth all things, endureth all things. Love never faileth, but whether there be prophecies, they shall fail. Whether there be tongues, they shall cease. Whether there be knowledge, it shall vanish away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part. But when that which is perfect is come, then that which is in part shall be done away. When I was a child, I spake as a child. I understood as a child. I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. For now we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then shall I know even as also I am known. And now abideth faith, hope, love, and these three, but the greatest of these is love. That was 1 Corinthians 13, let us all say.
Hallelujah.
Anyone listening in on the broadcast, will you please mute your phone? When I first speak.
Mute.
Mute. Yeah. M-U-T-E. Mute. Okay. I'm starting to mess with me today. My first speaker this morning will be Dr. Will Williams.
That the scripture lesson just encapsulated it all right there. You know, because what we read, this is really, one manifestation of that love, just showing us the vision, the revelation, his purpose and plan throughout the ages and dispensations. Okay. Let's see, what I want to do, I think, I want to try to, I don't know, it seems like I've been doing this a lot lately. I've been throwing out a lot of meat, but I had to cook it in the milk. You know, it's like, and really, there's nothing wrong with that, you know, because that way everybody gets fed, both, you know, the mature as well as the young. You know, see? And it would have to be that way, because we're down at a time, you know, the last days, you know, of time here. And just from a natural standpoint, you know, our children, you know, they're picking up things just, you know, just like that, you know. Whereas, you know, back in our days, you know, we were, you know, I guess compared to them now, you know, we're like dinosaurs, you know, going back, you know. Because, I mean, I remember the days of the vacuum tube, okay? You know, some of these kids wouldn't know what that is, see, you know, the vacuum tube, till someone invented the transistor that revolutionized, really, electronics. And so, likewise, when this doctrine is brought across in its proper way, that is to say, utilizing these charts, which is the representation of this divine vision and revelation, likewise, it will cause a revolution in a person's heart and mind. Okay. Now, I want to try to do something. I want to try to maybe pick up some things that we've gone into the last couple of Sundays, you know, if we can. Let me start off with Genesis 12 and 1. Because if you remember the last couple of Sundays, or the Sunday before last, like we was going through Joseph and things like that, and particularly the migratory truck here, see, all right? And how it points to the universe, this truck does, okay? And how it's a type of heavenly things as well, okay? Now, we have Genesis 12 and 1.
Genesis 12 and 1. Now Yahweh has said unto Abram, get thee out of thy country, and from thy kindred, and from thy father's house, unto the land that I will show thee. And I will make of thee a great nation, and I will bless thee, and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. And I will bless them that bless thee, and curse him that curseth thee, and in thee shall all families of the earth be blessed. So Abram departed as Yahweh had spoken unto him, and Lot went with him. And Abram was 75 years old when he departed out of Haran.
And Abram took Sarai his wife, and Lot his brother's son, and all their substance that they had gathered.
Where's your mic? I couldn't hear you.
Well, the mic went.
I know. That's why I couldn't hear you. What verse are you at?
Okay, now I'm on 5. Should I go back?
Yeah. Why don't you just start over? Because I couldn't even hear you.
All right. Genesis 12 and 1. Now Yahweh had said unto Abram, get thee out of thy country, and from thy kindred, and from thy father's house, unto the land that I will show thee. And I will make thee of thee a great nation, and I will bless thee, and make thine name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. And I will bless them that bless thee, and curse him that curseth thee, and in thee shall all families of the earth be blessed. So Abram departed, as Yahweh had spoken unto him.
Okay, that's good enough, yeah. Finish that verse.
So Abram departed as Yahweh had spoken unto him, and Lot went with him. And Abram was 75 years old when he departed out of Haran.
Okay. Now, we have that on the map here. See, map of the Middle East back here. We have this. You see, Abraham came from Ur of the Chaldees. That's the city right here. See, it's Sumer. See, that's the ancient name for Babylon. You know, the Sumeria, Ur of the Chaldees. The Euphrates River. This green area here, see, this is called the Fertile Crescent. This is called Mesopotamia, meaning the land between the two rivers. The Euphrates River here, the Tigris River here. Abraham migrated from Ur of the Chaldees up, and he made it up here to Haran. And so when he came down from Haran, he had to cross the Euphrates River and come down from the north into Canaan's land. By him coming across the Euphrates River, coming from Haran, coming across the Euphrates River, that made Abraham the first Hebrew. Now the word Hebrew comes from the word Habiru, which is ancient Babylonian. The word Habiru means one from across the river. And that's what Abraham did. He came from across the Euphrates River. Okay? And he was the first Hebrew. Because Yahweh said he was going to make from him many nations. Okay? Now, get Genesis 15 and 12.
Genesis 15 and 12. And when the sun was going down, a deep sleep fell upon Abram, and lo, a horror of great darkness fell upon him. And he said unto Abram, know of a surety that thy seed shall be a stranger in a land that is not theirs, and shall serve them, and they shall afflict them 400 years. Mm-hmm. And also that nation whom they shall serve I will judge, and afterward shall they come out with great substance.
Okay. They'll come out with great substance. Okay. Now, when Yahweh said that to Abraham, that's when the bondage began. Even though Abraham has no offspring at this point. But when Yahweh said there'll be about 40, that's when it began, because he declared it.
Right, right.
Okay? So, Abraham, I'm just cutting it up short, so because I'm trying to get to a couple of points, you know, that we kind of went over in the last couple of Sundays. Abraham had Isaac, Isaac had Jacob, Jacob had 12 sons. We went over this a couple of Sundays ago about Joseph. He was the forerunner, set down here. Okay, and then 70 souls afterwards came down, and this was because of a famine. Actually, when you read the scriptures, there was three famines during the three generations of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Alright? I won't get into details on that, but I'm just showing you Yahweh's just working his purpose, okay? But then the last one, as I said, Joseph was sent down as a forerunner, and then 70 souls came down. Maybe we should, I'll start with the Genesis 50 and 19.
Genesis 50 and 19.
Mm-hmm.
And Joseph said unto them, fear not, for am I in the place of El Shaddai?
No, Elohim? Say Elohim, thank you. Because that's not what it says in the Holy Name Bible, right? Right, thank you.
But as for you, you thought evil against me. But Elohim meant it unto good to bring to pass, and it is this day, to save much people alive.
Okay, now he said, am I in the place of Elohim, which he was.
Right.
See? Yahweh set him up that way. See, because he was down, and he was El Shaddai, mind you, because he was the Almighty Provider. Because during the famine that engripped the whole world, and Joseph, due to his interpretation of Pharaoh's dream that warned the people, Joseph was in charge of the granary. He was the one. That when the people came to Pharaoh and they said, Pharaoh, feed us, Pharaoh just said, go see Joseph. And whatever he says, you do it. Okay? Now, because of that, Egypt got fat. Mm-hmm. Right? They built two treasure cities. Textbook. Maybe I can show it. First slide. I'm looking for the illustration of Moses' trip out of Egypt. So I said, I know it's in the first volume. Thank you. Just to kind of give you an illustration here. If you would, don't want to break that. Oops.
Page 13.
Hold it up. Let me see what you have. Yeah, what page is that?
13.
13. Yeah, that's it. That's it. Okay.
Well, I don't want to tear your book, Dr. Samuel, so, yeah. If I'm going to tear a book, I may as well tear mine. No, I'll get mine. And it's already tore up. Okay. Yeah. I had gone through several incarnations. I've been giving them away and all that kind of stuff. You know, we need to figure out a way to publish these books. Yeah. You know, we need to do that. I know we have them on CD, and you know, we do make them available to anybody who wants them. You can email me if you like, and I'll send them to you by email if you like. Just let me know, okay? All right, and see now, here we got, Goshen and Pithom and Ramesses. These are the two cities that were built. And Goshen, this was in the land of Egypt where the Israelites was given, they were given land aside from the Egyptians, okay? Because, see, to the Egyptians, see, the Hebrews were mostly sheep herders. And sheep was like an anathema to these people. Even though the Egyptians worshipped a whole lot of animals, for some reason they really didn't get at the sheep. Okay? But we have this illustration here. Dr. Kelly, maybe we could make a bigger one, you know, like a full size. My son did one, you know. What happened to that?
You got that.
Who? You gave it to him.
Yeah,
and he took it home?
We took it home, but we gave it to him.
Oh, because he didn't have it.
Well, how could he? That's a mystery.
Because it was at your house over here for a long time.
Interesting. Yeah. Anyway, we should reproduce this a larger size, because this is a, you know, because what we show here, we show Moses here at the burning bush, okay, all right, and he sent down to Egypt, and he got out this way. It starts here really, because he kills the Egyptian. Mm-hmm. Moses slews the Egyptian with the rod. And then it shows Moses' flight out of Egypt. And it shows the Great Pyramid here with 2520 on it, flanked by the two lesser pyramids, and the Sphinx here, okay? All right, and so over here, as we showed you, Goshen, Ramses, and Pithom, okay? That was two treasure cities down here in Egypt. Now, when Moses comes out of Egypt, see, 400 years, we told you that, from Abraham, he was told that they would be in an affliction for 400 years, and then they would come out, okay? Now, what I want is Psalms 90 and 4. Okay? Because I want to try and trying to pull some things together that we've gone over the last couple of Sundays or so.
Psalm 90 and 4.
Uh-huh.
For 1,000 years in thy sight are but as yesterday when it is past,
mm-hmm.
and as a watch in the night.
See, it's yesterday as it is past and as a watch in the night. So what we have here is what we're talking about is a day for a year, one day equals another year, one day equals 1,000. Years, okay, and 1,000 years is equal to one day. Now, Yahshua the Messiah, when he comes into the world, he's born in the year 4 BC and to 29 AD. Now, according to Usher, the world was created in the year 4004 BC, okay? Which means that there's a 4-year error in the calendar, which perhaps we'll get to in a minute. But still, Yahweh's purpose is still on time, because when you subtract this, it's going to show it's 4,000 years from Adam to Yahshua.
Right.
Okay? Now, one way you can look at that is this. Moses, when he wrote the days of creation, all right, on the fourth day of creation, he created the sun, the moon, and the stars. All right? And it's on the fourth day. So See, now, if a day is the same as 1,000 years, then that would be, the fourth day would be like 4,000 years. Right. And the S-U-N is a type of the S-O-N. Mm-hmm. Okay, so Yahshua would have to come in the 4,000th year. See, what's that scripture? I think it's Malachi. It says 5:2, the sun shall rise with healing in his wings.
I think it's 4:2.
4:2? Yeah, because I would think there's a fifth chapter of Malachi.
Malachi, 4:2.
Yeah.
But unto you that revere my name, shall the Son of Righteousness arise with healing in his wings.
Mm-hmm.
And he shall go forth and grow as the calf of the staff.
Okay, now the word son in there is spelled how?
S-U-N.
It's spelled S-U-N. See, but he's talking about the Son of Righteousness, or S-O-N. So I'm just trying to show you that they're synonymous. Okay, so now the Son is being placed up here on the fourth day, according to Moses' vision. Then Yahshua the Messiah is going to have to come in the 4,000th year from Adam. Okay? Now, the reason why I want to set that up is because if he's coming in the 4,000th year, and see, zero is a placeholder, see, then we have to see where somebody in the past, or in the books of the law, come in on the 4-something. See? Because, see, his mission is fulfilling. He's fulfilling everything jot and tittle of what's in the law and the prophets. That is to say, the Old Testament, the first 5 books of the Bible, the law, the books from Joshua and Malachi, the testimony. So if he's fulfilling that, I have to go back into the law and find what is being instituted or what he's fulfilling of. So now, if he's coming in the 4,000th year, and we just read about Abraham, see, talking about 400 years of bondage, see, then, how can I introduce this? Exodus, I think this is the 13th chapter. Where they're at the Red Sea. Where they're at the Red Sea.
Oh, they're at the Red Sea.
14:13. Thank you.
Exodus 14:13. And Moses said unto the people, fear you not, stand still and see the salvation of Yahweh, which he will show to you today.
Mm-hmm.
For the Egyptians whom you have seen today, you shall see them again no more or forever. Yahweh shall fight for you, and you shall hold your peace. And Yahweh said unto Moses, wherefore criest thou unto me?
Now see, now somebody standing next to him saying, why are you crying to me? Why?
Speak unto the children of Israel that they go forward.
No, why is he not? Why is Moses crying to him? Because see, Moses invoked his name. I said, well, what name did he invoke? He said salvation of Yahweh. Well, he invoked Yahshua. His name. He said Yahshua. Because that's what the name Yahshua means salvation of Yahweh. So when he says stand still and see the salvation of Yahweh, what he really says, stand still and see Yahshua. And there was a person standing next to him named Yahshua.
Yes.
Who responded saying, why are you crying to me?
Really?
Now where did he come from? Mm-hmm. Who is he? How does he fit into the scheme of things? See? Now we go back, because we did show in the other portrait about Moses at the burning bush. And this angel,
right.
Wait a minute, go get third chapter, but I'm not going to read this. I just want to expedite. I want to get to the part where Moses is complaining about, well, I'm slow of speech or something like that. That's the part I want you to start at.
Exodus 4:10. And Moses said unto Yahweh, but O Yahweh, I am not eloquent, neither hitherto, nor since thou hast spoken unto thy servant, for I am slow of speech and slow of tongue.
Okay, now he's saying he's slow of speech, slow of tongue, read.
And Yahweh said unto him, Who made man's mouth?
Uh-huh.
Or who make that make the dumb or deaf or the seeing or the blind?
Mm-hmm.
Have not I Yahweh?
Read.
Now therefore go, and I will be with thy mouth, and teach thee what thou shalt say. And he said, O Yahweh, send, I pray thee, by the hand of whom thou hast sent. And the anger of Yahweh kindled unto Moses, and he said, Is not Aaron the Levite thy brother? I know that he can speak well.
Mm-hmm.
And also, behold, he cometh forth to meet thee.
Now, wait a minute. How does he know that?
Yeah.
Now, of course, you can say, well, Yahweh, he knows everything. Yeah, well, yeah, you can say that, but wait a minute. What we're trying to show you is this. Here's Moses up there. He's talking to a phenomenal sight. He's having a vision. He's talking to an angel that's inside of a burning bush that's not being consumed. Okay? And this angel's talking to him, and he said, well, look, you know, we just read that about man's mouth, okay? And then the angel said, well, wait a minute. Ain't Moses your brother? Mm-hmm. You know, I know he speaks well. How does this angel know that he speaks well? Because he's down here in Egypt,
yeah.
Talking to Aaron. Mm-hmm. In fact, at the same time he's talking to Moses, he's telling Aaron, hey, look, your brother Moses is alive. I know you ain't seen him in 40 years, but he is alive. And I want you to go out here and just go out here to the desert and you'll meet him. See? So that's why the angel knew. And look, that was Joshua, the son of Nun, down there. And look, we talked about it earlier, before, about astral projection. Because that's what's happening here. Here's Joshua, the son of Nun. He is astral projecting from Egypt, out here to this burning bush. He's appearing to Moses, and at the same time, he's talking to his brother Aaron, letting them know. I said, man, I'm talking to your brother Moses right now, and he's alive. So I want you to go out and meet him. And at the same time, he's telling Moses, I said, well, I know your brother Aaron, you know, he speaks well. Why? Because I didn't talk to him, I heard him talk. You know, and he's on his way to see you. He's on his way to meet you. See, that was Joshua, son of Nun, down there. Now, where did he come from? Mm-hmm. Now, we said Joshua, son of Nun. Okay, well, he must have came from the Nun family, mm-hmm. Right? That's what somebody would think, you know. I say, oh, well, Hoshea, son of Nun, because he wasn't known as Joshua. He was known as Hoshea. He did not get that name until Moses come along, because they did not know who he was down here, other than he was Hoshea, the son of Nun. And he said, oh, yeah. Yeah. Old man Nun's son, not realizing that Nun, N-U-N, or Nun, means none after the flesh, also has a numerical value. It's also zero.
Right.
See, so he's the son of Nun,
right,
after the flesh. And look, Yahweh, who is pure spirit, see, his eternal power is the power of transmutation. See, he can take on shape and form any time and walk among, look, he is the creation itself. Let's put that in perspective. Right. See, he is the creation, and there's nothing he's not in. So he doesn't have to jump from one thing to another.
Right.
So it's no big thing for him. I mean, look, if he can make a man in his image and likeness, certainly he can just take on a body at any time and just start walking around. Okay? That's him. And that's what he did here, because he appeared down here in Egypt. Talking about Joshua or Hoshea, the son of Nun. He appeared down here in Egypt, and look, he appeared down in Egypt at the age of 30 years old. And he appeared that way. He appeared at the age of 30 years old. And here's another thing to consider. He appeared to be 30 years old for 30 years.
That's right.
That's right. And nobody could tell the difference. They just went along about their business. See? We got Joshua, as we established, he appeared in the 4,000th year. Zeros are placeholders. They could be added or subtracted because the principle is the four.
Right.
Likewise here for Joshua, son of Nun, he had to come in or appear in the 400th year from the promise of Abraham to appear to Daniel, and he appeared at 30 years old. Just like Yahshua, when he started his ministry, he was 30 years old, okay? And so, what's the scripture? Acts 7 and 6, get that first. Because we read with Abraham that it was told 400 years that they would be in bondage. Now the writer of the book of Acts, he's echoing that because he read, you know, the scriptures. Read
Acts 7 and 6. And Elohim spake on this wise,
mm-hmm.
that his seed should sojourn into a strange land,
mm-hmm.
and that they should bring them into bondage and entreat them evil 400 years.
400 years. See, he's echoing that which he, you know, which is what is in the book of Genesis with Abraham. All right, now get, I think it's Galatians 3:17.
Galatians 3 and 16.
16, okay.
Now to Abraham and his seed
mm-hmm.
were the promises made.
Read.
He saith not, and to seeds, plural,
mm-hmm.
but to the seed singular, is the Messiah.
But which is his seed singular. See, despite the fact that Abraham is going to be the father of many nations,
right.
the thing that he's the father of in a figure is that seed that's going to bless all nations.
Right.
See?
Right.
All right? But read.
And this I say, that the covenant that was confirmed before of Yahweh and his Messiah, the law which came 430 years after, cannot disannul that it should make the promise of not effect.
Now see, Paul, he says 430 years. Now someone would look at it and say, oh, this must be a scribal error or there's a conflict here. Not really, because you have to understand what they're looking at. See, one is looking at it from the 400 years, from the point when Joshua first appeared down here in Egypt. And Paul is looking at it for 430 years after the Israelites has come up out of Egypt. That's why we have written here, Melchizedek priesthood, Abrahamic promise. 430 years before the Mosaic law. Because when Joshua came up out of here, he was 30 years old. He appeared down here at the end of 400 years, and he was down here for 30 years. So when the Israelites came up out of Egypt, that would make 430 years.
Right.
See, why? Because, and see that 430, that's when the Israelites are baptized in the cloud and in the sea. Oh, get that. 1 Corinthians, 10 and 1. Yeah, that's what I want.
1 Corinthians 10 and 1.
Uh-huh.
Moreover, brethren, I would not that you should be ignorant
uh-huh.
of that all our fathers were under the cloud and all passed through the sea.
See, they were all under the cloud. See, they left Egypt led by a phenomenal cloud. A cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. All right? See, and they were baptized in this cloud, and when the Red Sea divided, they were baptized in the sea. Read.
And were all baptized unto Moses in the cloud and in the sea, and did all eat the same spiritual meat.
Read.
And did all drink the same spiritual drink. For they drank that spiritual rock that went with them, and that rock was the Messiah.
And that rock was the Messiah. Paul is telling you, the Messiah was back there with them. That rock was the Messiah. See? He was there, okay? And so when Joshua was baptized in the cloud in the sea along with the Israelites, that would be 430 years. That's why we have over here Joshua. When he comes to John the Baptist to be baptized, he has to be 30 years old. Let's read that. Luke.
Luke. And 23.
Thank you, Luke.
And Joshua himself began to be about 30 years of age,
uh-huh.
being, as was supposed, the son of Joseph, which was the son-in-law of Eli.
Okay. So now we established Joshua was 30 years old when he was baptized, and Joshua, son of Nun, had been on earth for 30 years when he was baptized in the cloud in the sea with the Israelites. Okay? Now, let me put something else in here at this point. If you remember when we talked about the death decree down here in Egypt, Play 14. this death, read Romans 1, 19 to 20.
Romans 1, 19 and 20. Because that which may be known of Yahweh is manifest in them, for Yahweh has showed it unto them.
Mm-hmm.
For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen.
Now, the invisible things of the world, the invisible things of the world in this case would be the angelic creation. Because it's invisible to us, I mean, because of the veils. But read.
Being understood by the things that are made,
mm-hmm.
even his eternal power and supernal nature.
Even his eternal power and supernal nature. As I said, his eternal power is the power of transmutation. That is the power he uses throughout the ages and dispensation. The power of transmutation. And his supernal nature, which is the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and these three are one. See, now, the natural things point to the spiritual things. When we talk about this migratory track, this Moses track is an example of the universe. Egypt would be like the physical creation, wilderness or the court roundabout, put it like that. Wilderness of Sinai would be like the holy place, which would be like the incorporeal creation or the angelic creation. Canaan's land would be like spirit law. See, or if I could reduce it like this, first heaven, second heaven, third heaven. The first two heavens emanate from the third. Okay? And one is a type of the other. Angelic creation, physical creation. One is a type of the other. There's a dotted line here. That means there is an interchange. One is a type of the other. To understand this, I just need to understand this in principle and apply it here.
Mm-hmm.
Which is what we did in one of the lessons. Because we talked about Shipra and Pua down here in Egypt because there was a death decree, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Shipra and Pua was told to do this. They were midwives, told to, you know, curtail these babies being made by the Hebrew women. Okay? I may as well read it.
Genesis 1:15.
Exodus.
Exodus 1:15.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, I'll just say Genesis.
And the king of Egypt spake to the Hebrew wives, of which the name of one was Shipra and the name of the other, Pua.
Uh-huh.
And he said, when you do the office of the midwife to the Hebrew women,
mm-hmm.
and see them upon their birth stool, if it be a son, then ye shall kill him.
Mm-hmm.
But if it be a daughter, then she shall live.
Mm-hmm.
But the midwives feared Elohim,
mm-hmm.
and did not as the king of Egypt commanded them,
mm-hmm.
but saved the male children alive.
Mm-hmm.
And the king of Egypt called for the midwives and said unto them, why have you done this thing, and have saved the men children alive? And the midwives said unto Pharaoh, because the Hebrew women are not as the Egyptian women, for they are active and are
dead. Oh, read that out of the King James Version.
For they are lively.
Thank you. I like that. They're lively. That's what they were. So they were lively. In other words, they just dropped, wrapped the baby and put it on the back. Just keep on walking. They were lively. That's what I'm saying. Thank you. I like that better. They were lively. Yes. You know. They had to be, because shoot, there was a death decree. Now, Shipra and Pua feared Elohim. See, and you take this and look at it in the same way in the angelic creation. Because in the angelic creation, it was a similar problem.
Yeah.
See, Pharaoh was reacting to the overabundance of Israelites in Egypt.
Mm-hmm.
They outnumbered them two to one. In other words, if he was to make a pie and divide it up, two-thirds of that pie would be the Hebrews, and one-third of that pie would be the Egyptians.
Mm-hmm.
Revelations 12 and 3.
And there appeared another wonder in heaven,
uh-huh.
and behold, a great red dragon,
Green.
Having seven heads and ten horns,
mm-hmm.
and seven crowns upon his head. and his tail drew the third part of the stars of heaven, and it cast them to the earth. And the dragon stood before the woman, which was ready to be delivered, for to devour her child as soon as it was born.
Okay, now, there was a war in heaven. And see, and there was, no, actually, there was a wonder that appeared in heaven, a dragon, and he drew one third of the stars. Okay, now, that was Lucifer up here. And see, and he drew one third of the angels, see, by telling them that he was it.
That's coming up. Okay. That's coming up.
Okay, go ahead.
And she brought forth a man-child who was to rule all nations with a rod of iron. And her child was brought up unto Elohim and to his throne. And the woman fled into the wilderness, where she hath a place prepared of Yahweh, mm-hmm. and they should feed her there 1,260 days. And there was war in heaven.
Mm-hmm.
Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought and his angels, and prevailed not.
Mm-hmm.
Neither was their place found any more in heaven.
Mm-hmm.
And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. And I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now is come salvation and strength,
mm-hmm.
and the kingdom of our Lord.
Now is come salvation and strength. Why? Because it was not apparent before. It was not apparent at that time.
Mm-hmm.
For this reason. Because we told you Joshua was down here in Egypt. He was walking among the Israelites, and they didn't know, they had no idea who he was.
That's right.
He looked just like any other Jumbo. Who's that guy? Oh, that's Hoshea. Hoshea? Yeah, you know, old man Nun's son.
Oh, old man
Nun's son.
Oh,
okay. What tribe is he from? Ephraim, I think. That's all they know. And see, that's the power, because Yahweh just, you know, that's just the power of Yahweh right there, you know? They didn't know who he was. Likewise, Yahshua, or Elohim rather, walked among the angels. He looked just like any other angel. But yet there was, and Lucifer up here, when he drew that one third of the stars, what he was doing was birth control. Just like Pharaoh was doing down here. Trying to use birth control. Why? And look, Lucifer, draw a line here. It's like the veil here. We have angels on the veil. Mm-hmm. Lucifer is on the veil. He's the brightest thing on the veil. This is the veil that covereth.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
The most holy place. Covers the throne. So don't you think, and he can go any part of the veil. He can stand in front of the, he can go on the side. He can go up on top and look down. Mm-hmm. He can assume any position on the veil. So don't you think that he approached Michael and Gabriel and said, hey, look, Mike, Gabe, look here, fellas. Look, I need y'all to go out and you know, bring all these other angels to me, and you know, and so you just bring them to me, you know, because see, he's looking.
Mm-hmm.
He's looking for that one. The scripture says, thou art wiser than Daniel. He knew that Elohim was wise, and he just figured, it's just like, hey, you know, if I could just find him and yeah, you know, it's like, in these Japanese shows, like, these samurai shows, like, they have, if you ever watch them, like, sometimes they go into disguise, they'll go take another identity, but they may be an important person, but if they're, like, undercover and they take another person's identity, that makes them vulnerable to attack, because then somebody can come along and kill them, and they say, oh, well, you killed the prime minister. Well, no, he wasn't the prime minister, he was saying he was so-and-so, something else. I didn't know he was really, you know, so I just, you know, that'd be like an excuse, you know, say, oh, well, you know, I didn't know he was, such a high up, you know, he came across like, you know, Joe Blow, you know, the peanut seller or something, you know. I didn't know who he was, but but Lucifer knew, he knew was, and he's out there looking, why, and I can draw a line. Come over here. This is the most holy place. This is Canaan land. You read the story of King Saul.
Mm-hmm.
See, and how King Saul was plagued with demons, and how he became jealous of David after David killed Goliath.
Mm-hmm.
See, because the women, you know, sang David's praises. You know, it says, Saul has slain his thousands, his thousands, and David slain his tens of thousands, tens of thousands. And Saul like, wait a minute, I'm the king, you know. And this shepherd boy is getting more, you know, he's getting more play than me, more fame. What's up? And so David had to go into hiding. And Saul went looking for him. Saul went looking for him. Why? Because up here, Lucifer was looking for Yahshua. Down here, Pharaoh, Lucifer, who Lucifer was incarnated in, was looking for Joshua.
That's right. Impersonating Pharaoh and impersonating Saul too.
Well, see, Pharaoh was a type. See, go back to the first chapter in the beginning. Where, just read the beginning. First, just read the beginning.
Lucifer,
Revelations 12 and 1. And there are
Exodus.
Oh, Exodus.
Exodus, first chapter. That's where you were at, right?
No, I was in Revelation.
I was pointing to
Joshua. Started one?
Yeah. I'm sorry.
Now, these are the names of the children of Israel which came unto Egypt.
Uh-huh.
Every man in his household came with Jacob, Reuben, Simeon, Levi, and Judah, Issachar, Zebulun, Benjamin, Dan, Naphtali, Gad and Asher, and all the souls that came out of the loins of Jacob were 70 souls.
70 souls that came down here. Read.
For Joseph was in Egypt.
Read.
And Joseph died, and all his brethren, and all the generation, and the children of Israel were fruitful, and increased abundantly, and multiplied, and grew exceedingly mighty. And the land was filled with them.
And the land was filled, and they overflowed. They outnumbered the natural inhabitants.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the old saying is, you know, they breed it like rabbits. You know, and people think that's so funny because I used to go hunting with my dad, and people like rabbits, because they're nice furry little things and cute, you know, they have cartoons like Bugs Bunny, cute. But actually, you go out in the real rural areas, you know, and talk to the farmers. A farmer will tell you. A rabbit is a pest.
Mm-hmm.
I remember my father and my uncles, we would get up early in the morning, and I mean early, I mean like about 4 o'clock in the morning, be out on the road, and we'd be knocking on some farmer's door like 4:30 in the morning. And they're up because farm people get up at that morning.
Mm-hmm.
And we get up, and so we're standing out there with our shotguns and saying, excuse me, sir, we'd like to go hunting on your property.
Mm-hmm.
And he's like, sure, go right ahead. Because
mm-hmm.
you know why? As far as that farmer is concerned, that's a free extermination service.
Because
we out there hunting rabbits.
Yeah.
You know, and I remember one time we was out there, you out there all day too, buddy, from sun up to sundown, and if you didn't bring a lunch, boy, you are going to be famished at the end of the day. And so we came back, we caught, you know, not a whole lot of few, and we told the farmer, said, well, what'd you get? I said, we got so much. And he's like, no, I'm sorry, that ain't enough. You need to go back out there and get some more. You know? So that's how Pharaoh looked at it. I was like, because they were over in the land of Goshen, and then now the whole land is filled with, you know, with Hebrews, and they're like, what in the world? So they pressed them, they put them into slavery. Okay, they wanted to exterminate them. And see, and Lucifer was in Carthage. Keep reading.
Now there arose a new king over Egypt. Which knew not Joseph.
Now a king that knew not Joseph. Now that doesn't mean he didn't know anything about Joseph. What it means is he didn't recognize Joseph.
Mm-hmm.
He didn't recognize who he was. In other words, he disregarded Joseph.
Yeah.
Okay? Just like there arose an angel up here whose brightness and glory, and he knew not Elohim.
Mm-hmm.
Didn't mean he didn't know anything about Elohim. He just refused to recognize who he was.
Mm-hmm.
And stepped out there and said, oh, well, this is who I am. This is what I'm going to do.
Yeah.
See? That's what happened out here. And Joseph was a type. Remember, he was a type of Elohim. So then here come Pharaoh come along, disrespecting Joseph, just like Lucifer come along, disrespecting Elohim.
Mm-hmm.
So same thing in principle. You're taking one from the migratory tract to apply it in the angelic. Because one is a reflection of the other.
That's right.
Yeah.
See, that's the point I'm trying to get you to see. And let me bring this up. Go back to Genesis, back here. I think it's the third chapter of Genesis.
And one.
Just get the woman, what's about the woman, what's said to the woman. Read it all about, you know, the punishment that was going to happen to Adam, Eve, and the serpent.
1 and 10. And he said, I heard thy voice in the garden, and I was afraid, because I was naked, and I hid myself.
1 and 10?
3 and 10.
3 and 10. And he said, who told thee that thou was naked?
Uh-huh.
Hast thou eaten of the tree whereof I commanded thee that thou shouldest not eat?
Mm-hmm.
And the man said, the woman whom thou gavest to be with me,
mm-hmm.
she gave me of the tree, and I did eat.
Mm-hmm.
And Yahweh Elohim said unto the woman,
uh-huh.
what is this that thou hast done? And the woman said, the serpent beguiled me, mm-hmm. and I did eat.
Mm-hmm.
And Yahweh Elohim said unto the serpent,
mm-hmm.
because thou hast done this, thou art cursed above all cattle,
mm-hmm.
and above every beast of the field. Upon thy belly shall thou go, and thus shalt thou eat all the days of thy life. Mm-hmm. And I will put an enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed.
Mm-hmm. Okay, now let me, I'm going to put enmity between thy seed and her seed. Read.
He shall bruise thy head,
uh-huh.
and thou shalt bruise his heel.
Uh-huh.
Unto the woman he said, I will greatly multiply thy pain and thy conception. In pain thou shalt bring forth children, and thy desire shall be unto thy husband.
Okay.
And he shall rule over thee.
Okay, now this is what was said to all of the, you know, to the woman and to the serpent. Mm-hmm. Okay, let me as well read Adam.
And he said unto Adam, he said, because thou hast hearkened unto the voice of thy wife,
mm-hmm.
and hast eaten of the tree of which I commanded thee, saying, thou shalt not eat of it.
Mm-hmm.
Cursed is the ground for thy sake,
mm-hmm.
and sorrow shall thou eat of it all the days of thy life.
Mm-hmm.
Thorns and thistles shall it bring forth to thee, and thou shalt eat the herbs of the field.
Mm-hmm.
And the sweat of thy face shall I eat bread till thou return unto the ground. For out of it wast thou taken, for dust thou art, and unto the dust thou shalt return.
All right. Now, point I want to get here is what was said to the woman and what was said to the serpent. Said her seed and his and the serpent's seed, they would be at enmity with each other. Get, I think it's Timothy, 1 Timothy, is it 2:13?
Mm-hmm.
See, now we said that the serpent seed on his belly he shall fall in dust. He shall eat all the days of his life. That means this. He has to incarnate in the flesh. Okay?
1 Timothy 2:13. For Adam was first born, then Eve.
Read.
And Adam was not deceived.
Now Adam wasn't deceived up here. See, we got it up here. He's looking at her. He wasn't deceived, you know, but read.
But the woman, being deceived, was in the transgression.
Read.
Notwithstanding, she shall be saved in childbearing.
Now she shall be saved in childbearing. See, read.
If they continue in faith and charity and holiness with sobriety.
Now she shall be saved in childbearing. The serpent or Lucifer or Satan knew that as well.
Mm-hmm.
That's why in Egypt he set up a birth control measure.
Mm-hmm.
To kill the boy there, because he sensed it. He knew it was coming. However, Yahweh, through a curve, instead of coming through the loins of a woman, he just, bam, he just materialized there. Mm-hmm. It's a full-grown man.
Yeah.
However, Yahshua Messiah, when he come along, see, he came to the loins of a woman. Mm-hmm. And there was a death decree out when he came.
Yeah.
See, Herod killed all the babies in Bethlehem looking for him. Mm-hmm. See, birth control, that's a hallmark of the mystery of iniquity. Why? Because it was practiced up here. When he, his tale, or his lie, tale, T-A-L-E, drew one third of the stars. That was committing genocide right there. For that one third, as far as they're concerned, they're consigned to this outer darkness, to death, to destruction. They're consigned to that. So really, him drawing them was really committing, it was an act of genocide on Lucifer's part. Just drawing them into his orbit. Okay? At one third. But you see, he's looking. See, he's looking for those, you know, being born. And that extends to today. Because we believe that you have to be born again, spiritually speaking.
That's right.
And that's one thing he doesn't want you to be. He does not want you to be spiritually born.
Mm-hmm.
He wants you to remain spiritually dead.
Yeah. Yeah.
See? Even if you're pregnant, impregnated with the Holy Spirit, so to speak, you know, just from a natural standpoint, like if a pregnant woman comes, you don't want her to fall down some steps,
right,
or something like that, or slip, or a puddle, you know, or eat something, you know, eat shellfish or something, you know, that might affect, you know, eat something that, you understand my question? Right. You just take the natural,
right,
and you apply it to the spiritual, you know. You don't want to slip and fall into one of these different doctors over here. You don't want to eat, you know, to these various opinions and theories, because, you know, it may make you sick.
Yeah, right.
You understand? It's the same thing spiritually.
Right.
All right? Now, I wanted to bring that part out, because I wanted to tie it into to what we had been going through in the other lessons. See, and also, something else you can consider. See, about Joshua's son, okay, Joshua's down here, and he's appearing down here. And so when the Egyptians come up out, I mean, when the Israelites come up out of Egypt, okay, now, where's that scripture at? It said they spoiled them. That's what I want. It's in Exodus. That's the scripture I want. They said they spoiled the Egyptians. Because there were 10 devastating plagues that was poured out on the Egyptians.
Mm-hmm.
Right? The last plague being the institution of the Passover. And during that plague, the firstborn of man and beast was subject to death if they didn't have the blood sign on the door. The angel would pass over their house, and if they did not have the blood sign on the door, then the firstborn of that house, or, you know, that household, man and beast, would die. And look, the angel that passed over the people's house to check on everybody to see if they had the blood sign, that was Joshua, son of Nun. He was that death angel down here in Egypt.
Exodus 12 and 36.
Read.
Maybe 35.
All right.
And the children of Israel had done according to the words of Moses, and they had demanded of the Egyptian jewels of silver and jewels of gold and raiment.
Mm-hmm.
And Yahweh had given the people favor in the sight of the Egyptian, so that they gave to them such things as they demanded, and they spoiled from the Egyptians. But it said recovered here, but it's spoiled.
It's spoiled. I want the word spoiled. I don't like
it. And they spoiled the Egyptians.
Yeah, they spoiled. In other words, they took it from them. And sure, they got it from the people. There were people that gave them stuff.
Mm-hmm.
But do you want to know where they got the bulk of this spoil from?
Why does it say they borrowed?
I don't know. That's the translator. Because see, what do you mean borrow? Well, because once they get out into the wilderness, what, they going to come back and give it back to them? See? What version you got over there?
Well, Mike says borrowed.
What version do you have?
Ryrie.
The Ryrie says borrowed.
Borrowed. I don't know why Charles Ryrie would say that. Borrow, because they took it from them. And they weren't going to get it back. And here's the reason why they weren't going to get it back.
Right.
See, look here. See, these are the two cities, Pithom and Ramses. Okay, this is where they got the bulk of their treasure from. They're spoiled, see. Okay, and they took it with them. Okay, now, the reason why they took it with them, because when they get out here to this wilderness, in time, they're going to make this tabernacle. And this tabernacle is going to be made out of the goods,
there you go,
that was spoiled by the Egyptians.
Mm-hmm.
Why? Because it's a type. See, this tabernacle came forth, took on shape and form from the unformed mass of goods that they took from the Egyptians, the gold, the silver, the linen, so forth and so on. It was just all a big mass. And then out of that mass, in part, came this tabernacle. Why? Because up here, you got Yahweh, pure spirit. Didn't take all of pure spirit for Elohim to take on shape and form. Just like it didn't take all the gold and silver and linen and stuff that they took from the Egyptians for this tabernacle to take on shape and form. You see, this is why it's important to read the scriptures, to understand the migratory track, so that you can look at the things and the stories and understand the spiritual principles behind them. See? Because it's all integrated, okay?
In the King James, it says they borrowed, and then in the Holy Name, it says they demanded.
The translator. The translator, see, that's the thing. See, and there are errors in the Bible. There's no perfect, there's no such thing as a perfect Bible in the world. It just isn't. Because each Bible is subject to the whim of the translators, even down to the grammar, okay? However, we're not relying on a version of the Bible.
Right, bring it home.
We're relying on a vision, a panoramic vision and revelation. In fact, if you understand this panoramic vision and revelation, you will know how to correct the Bible. Mm-hmm. Here's a quick correction, right quick. John 4:24, read it as it is.
In the King James?
Just read it at whatever you read. Okay.
John 4:24. Yeah, God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth.
Now see, now it says God is a spirit, and they that worship him in spirit must worship him in spirit and in truth. Now see, now that's, we can do a couple of corrections right there. One, we'll change it from God to Yahweh.
Right.
And then we'll kick that A out of that sentence.
Yes.
So that it would read, Yahweh is spirit, yes, as opposed to Yahweh is a spirit. Because if you say Yahweh is a spirit, then you infer that there's another kind of spirit,
right,
in existence, in operation, and we have to, I don't know, I guess we have to go see, we have to see about one and then go see about the other. Or any others if they're supposedly multiples. But the point we're trying to convey is that there's only one spirit. Mm-hmm. And that spirit is Yahweh. And out of that spirit, there are two mysteries in operation. Okay? And that one, and see, but I'm just showing you, understanding this vision and the pattern, we corrected that Bible. Now somebody could come along and be arbitrary, oh no, that's not, but we can get into it and show, mm-hmm, that there's only one spirit. Because, mm-hmm, there are scriptures that say there's only one spirit.
Right.
Okay? Mm-hmm. All right. Now, let's get back to here. Now, I wanted to show that because I know I went through it with Joseph and stuff, and I want to kind of get into it again and kind of bring some other things back so that we could see how more connected this is with the scriptures and the purpose being in operation, especially with Joshua, son of Nun. Okay, now Joshua, son of Nun, let's get Exodus 23 and 20. Bring that up. See, because he's down here in Egypt, and he's down here, you'll see, when Moses and Aaron are down here, when Moses and Aaron meet out here in the wilderness, they meet out here in the middle of the wilderness. And then they, and both of them are coming down together. And they're coming down into Egypt, and they're coming to stand forth in front of Pharaoh. Now Moses represents the law, and Aaron represents the prophecy or the testimony.
Right.
So now you got the law and the testimony, or two divine witnesses,
right,
to witness against Pharaoh. And you got Joshua, son of Nun, here, because who do you think is giving Moses the instruction? Remember, Moses had an impediment of speech. So he ain't doing the talking. He's telling Aaron what to say. And Aaron, who's got the nice voice, he said, thus say Yahweh Elohim of Israel, let my people go. See? And Joshua's telling Moses, listen, now if you don't do it, tell him I'm going to, you know, tell him I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that, I'm going to turn the Nile River to blood. But look, I'm a hardened heart anyway. Okay? And that's by purpose. Hardening his heart. See? So that Yahweh can show forth his power. Alright, now, they're coming up out of Egypt, they're following a phenomenal cloud. Read.
Exodus 23:20. Behold, I send an angel before thee to keep thee in the way, and to bring thee into the place which I have prepared.
Mm-hmm.
Beware of him, and obey his voice, provoke him not, for he will not pardon your transgressions, for my name is in him.
For my name is in him, okay. Now that's the angel in the cloud that they were following, alright? Now, I want
Numbers 14 and 34. After the number of the days in which ye survey the land, even 40 days, each day for a year, shall ye bear your iniquities. Even 40 years, you shall know the withdrawal of my promise.
Okay, now, that is what's called prophetic time. That is a day for a year. Okay, now the Israelites, let's get we're in Numbers. Mm-hmm. That's 13 and 1.
Numbers 13 and 1. And Yahweh spake unto Moses, saying, Send thou men that they may search the land of Canaan, which I give unto the children of Israel, of every tribe of their fathers. So you send a man, every one a ruler among them. And Moses, by the commandment of Yahweh, sent them from the wilderness of Paran. All these men were heads of the children of Israel.
Okay, now he sent out 12 spies. They were, you know, designated heads from each tribe. Now we're just going to expedite this and jump down to 8.
8. Of the tribe of Ephraim, Oshea, the son of Nun.
Now from the tribe of Ephraim, Oshea, the son of Nun. See? Now, here's Hoshea, the son of Nun. Okay.
Of the tribe of Benjamin.
No, I don't need all that. Okay, jump down to 16.
16. These are the names of the men which Moses sent to spy out the land. And Moses called Hoshea, the son of Nun, Jehoshua.
So Yahashua or Yahoshua?
Yehoshua.
Or Yahoshua. In other words, prior to that, everybody knew him as Hoshea. Because they didn't know the name Yahweh down, and not until Moses brought it. See, but it was everybody else called him Hoshea, but it was Moses that called him Yahashua or Yahoshua or Yahshua. But Moses gave him that, told him, said that. And everybody else heard it, and they said, oh, okay. See, but now, these are the 12 spies that went out and spied out this land. And when they spied it out, they came back, 10 of them came back with a not so favorable report. Saying, you know, they're saying that, well, you know, there's giants up there, we can't take the land, the cities are heavily armed and fortified. Whereas the two that had a good report, who happened to be Joshua and Caleb, they even brought back a giant cluster of grapes to prove it. See, but the people believed the other 10. Now, it took those 12 spies 40 days to spy out this land. So because the people believed the 10 report, the 10 spies believed them, and they got really kind of disheartened of that, Yahweh punished them a day for a year. So they ended up being out here 40 years based on the 40 days that the spies spied out the land. So they're out here 40 years, okay? Now, if that be the case, see, when we look over here, with Joshua, he's 30 years old when he comes up out of Egypt, and he's 40 years old when he crosses the Jordan River. Now, Joshua, in the fulfillment, see, he's out there in Matthew 4 and 1. See, after he's baptized by John the Baptist, he straightway went into the wilderness of Judea.
Then was Joshua led up of the spirit of the will. Of the spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the adversary. And after he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry.
Now he's out there 40 days and 40 nights. Why? This is a fulfillment of the Israelites being out here in the wilderness 40 years. A day for a year. Okay? Now, Joshua, son of Nun, let's get that. I think it's Exodus, the 34th chapter. No, we're going to get there. But first get Deuteronomy 18:15. Get that first, and then I think we want Deuteronomy 34th chapter.
Deuteronomy 18:15. Yahweh thy Elohim will raise up unto thee a prophet from the midst of thee, of thy brethren like unto me, unto him you shall hearken.
Okay, now I said, now Yahweh's going to raise up a brethren from the midst of thee, liken unto me. Now you hearken unto him. Now he's letting you know who that is. See, the person, he's pointing them out who he is. That's going to be Joshua, the son of Nun, who's going to take his place. All right? Now, I think it's Deuteronomy, the 34th chapter. Yeah, 34 and 5. Start there.
So Moses, the servant of Yahweh, died there in the land of Moab, according to the word of Yahweh. And he buried him in the valley in the land of Moab, over against Beth Peor. But no man knoweth of his sepulchre unto this day. And Moses was 120 years old when he died. His eye was not dim, nor his natural force abated. And the children of Israel wept for Moses in the plain of Moab 30 days. So the days of weeping and mourning for Moses were ended. And Joshua the son of Nun was full of the spirit of wisdom, For Moses had laid his hands upon him, and the children of Israel hearkened unto him, and did as Yahweh commanded Moses.
Okay, so now Moses dies, and Joshua succeeds him. Okay. Before we go over the king's land, let's go back to Egypt for a minute. Because we said that Joshua, the son of Nun, came from the tribe of Ephraim. Okay. Now, if Joshua is Yahweh Elohim manifested in the flesh, why was he attached to the tribe of Ephraim? Why not the tribe of Naphtali? Or the tribe of Judah? Or the tribe of Benjamin, for that matter? Why Ephraim? Of all the tribes, why Ephraim? Okay? Let's go back to Genesis. I think it's 26. No, not 26, 46, I mean.
No,
it's 48. It's 48 and 8. That's what I want. Okay, now, before you start. Now, we said that Joseph was down here in Egypt. He's a type of El Shaddai. Put your finger there. Put your finger there and get... We'll get it after we read it. We'll get it after we read this.
Genesis 48 and 8. And Israel beheld Joseph's son. Mm-hmm. He beheld Joseph's sons and said, "Who are these?"
Read.
And Joseph said unto his father, "They are my sons, whom Yahweh hath given me in this place."
Mm-hmm.
And he said, "Bring them, I pray thee, unto me, and I will bless them." Now the eyes of Israel were dim for age, so that he could not see.
Mm-hmm.
And he brought them near unto him, and mm-hmm. he kissed them and embraced them.
Now here's, here's Jacob, or Israel. See, he's old, he's dying, and so Joseph, like the dutiful son, he's bringing his sons up. He's like, "Pops, I want you to lay the blessing on my sons." Okay, read.
And Israel said unto Joseph, "I had not thought to see thy face,
uh-huh.
and lo, Elohim has showed me also thy seed."
Mm-hmm.
And Joseph brought them up from between his knees,
uh-huh.
and he bowed himself with his face to the earth.
Now his Jacob, Israel, he's up on his bed, or his cot, he's laying there. And so Joseph, he's showing obeisance to his father. He's bowing down, and he brings his sons out. They're little kids. He brings his sons out, all right? Read.
And Joseph took them both, Ephraim in his right hand.
Now, see, he took Ephraim, in his right hand.
Israel's left hand.
I'm Israel. So he's bringing them up, and he's bringing Ephraim, the youngest son, toward Israel's left hand. Read.
And Manasseh in his left hand toward Israel's right hand.
And Manasseh, who was the eldest son, towards Israel's right hand. Because the right hand is the blessing. It's very symbolic. The right hand, this is my right hand man, my right hand son, that kind of thing. It's just significant. Okay? The right hand, the blessing of the right hand. Okay, so that's what's happening. So here's Ephraim here. Here's Manasseh here, the elder and the younger. Read.
And brought them near to him. And Israel stretched out his right hand and laid upon Ephraim's head, who was the younger.
Now see, this is what he did. Now mind you, Joseph, he's in front of his father. He's bowing down.
Right.
He's bowing down in front of him. Because this is what he bowed down in front of him, and they took his kids, and then he just pushed them in front, still showing obeisance,
right. mm-hmm.
To his father. So he ain't seeing what's going on because, Israel's taking his right hand and he put it on Ephraim's head, breathe.
And his left hand upon Manasseh's head. Guiding his hands wittingly.
Wittingly. In other words, he knew what he was doing. It wasn't an accident.
Right.
Read.
For Manasseh was the firstborn.
Read.
And he blessed Joseph and said, "Elohim, before whom my fathers Abraham and Isaac did walk, the Elohim which fed me all day my life unto this day,
mm-hmm.
the angel which redeemed me from all evil, bless the lands,
mm-hmm.
and let my name be named on them, and
mm-hmm.
the name of my fathers Abraham and Isaac, and let them grow into a multitude in the midst of the earth." And when Joseph saw that his father laid his right hand upon the head of Ephraim,
mm-hmm.
it displeased him.
And see, in other words, now he's looking up, and he's like, well, wait a minute here. Read.
And he held up the father's hand to remove it from Ephraim's head.
In other words, he went over there and got Pop's hand, grabbed it, and took it off of his head, read.
Unto Manasseh.
And put it on Manasseh's head. And I said, look, Pop, read.
And Joseph said unto his father, not so, my father.
Not so, man, read.
For this is the firstborn.
This is the firstborn.
Put thy right hand.
Put your right hand. Give him the blessing here. This is the firstborn. Read.
And his father refused and said, I know it.
I know it.
He also shall become a people.
He'll be a people.
And he also shall be great.
And he's going to be great.
But truly, his younger brother will be greater than him.
Read.
And his seed shall become a multitude of nations.
Why? Because Joshua the son of Nun, who was the true seed of Abraham, was attached to that tribe.
Very good.
Now get Genesis 50th chapter. We read 19, just get down below that with Joseph. 50 and 22.
And Joseph dwelt in Egypt. He and his father's house
were
to live 110 years.
Read.
And Joseph saw Ephraim's children of the third generation, the children also of Machir, and the son of Manasseh were brought up upon Joseph's knee. And Joseph said unto his brothers, I die. And Elohim will surely visit you. And bring you out of this land.
And he's going to bring you up out of this land.
Which he swore to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. And Joseph took an oath of the children of Israel, saying, Elohim will surely visit you, and ye shall carry up my bones from hence. So Joseph died, being 110 years old.
He's 110 years old. Keep that number in mind.
And was embalmed, and they embalmed him, and he was put in a coffin in Egypt.
Okay, now when the Israelites did leave Egypt, they took Joseph's bones and they carried them with them all the way to Canaan's land. Okay, now let's go back to where we were. We've already established Joshua being 30 years old when he appeared in Egypt. Joshua fulfilled that by being baptized by John the Baptist at 30. Joshua was 40 years with the Israelites in the wilderness. That's fulfilled by Joshua being here 40 days in the wilderness of Judea, one day for a year. Okay? Now, let's see if we can throw some, I got time, we can throw some, a couple other things in here. Joshua, maybe the fourth chapter, I'm thinking. I want 1 and 10, but I need something else, like, quick. Go back. Okay, now I know what I want to do. Go back to Deuteronomy 34 and 8. That's what I want.
Deuteronomy 34 and 8.
And
the children of Israel wept for Moses in the plains of Moab 30 days, so the days of weeping and mourning for Moses were ended.
Now, they wept for Moses in the plains of Moab for 30 days. In other words, see, on this side of the river, the Jordan River. See, because he was buried in Mount Nebo. So they wept for him for 30 days. Okay, and see, the Jordan River represents the veil of the flesh. All right, now, that's 30 days. Now get Joshua 1 and 10.
Then Joshua commanded the officers of the people, saying, pass through the host, and command the people, saying, prepare you victual, for within 3 days you shall pass over this Jordan, to go in to possess the land which Yahweh your Elohim giveth you to possess it.
All right, so now 3 days, see, prepare victual. So that's 30 and 3, that's 33 days, and then they traverse the veil to go into Canaan's land. Why? Because that's pointing to Yahshua Messiah's 33 years in the flesh. See? At the veil. Because see, the River Jordan divided, and you know, divided just like the Red Sea did. Maybe we should read that. Second to see.
Joshua 3 and 13.
Mm-hmm.
And it shall come to pass, as soon as the soles of the feet of the priests that bear the ark, that bear the ark of Yahweh, the Elohim of all the earth, shall rest in the waters of Jordan, that the waters of Jordan shall be cut off from the waters that shall come down from above, and they shall stand upon a heap. And it came to pass, when the people removed from their tents to pass over Jordan, and the priests bearing the ark of the covenant before the people, and as they that bear the ark were come unto Jordan, and the feet of the priests that bear the ark were dipped in the brim of the water, for Jordan overflowed all its banks all the time of the harvest, that the waters which came down from above stood and rose up upon a heap very far from the city Adam, and that is besides Zeraton, and those that came down toward the sea of the plains, even the salt sea failed and were cut off, and the people passed over right against Jericho. And the priest that bare the ark of the covenant of Yahweh stood firm on dry ground in the midst of Jordan, and all the Israelites passed over on dry ground until all the people were passed clean over Jordan.
Okay, so the same thing happened here as it happened in the Red Sea. They crossed over Jordan. But that happened 33 days after the death of Moses. See, they crossed the Jordan, or divided the Jordan, just like here. 33 years, Joshua's life. And see what happened. The veil in the temple rent in twain. See, one is pointing to the other. The division of the Jordan is like the rending of the veil in the temple. And it happened 33 days after Moses, just like the veil in the temple rented in twain, 33 years after the death of Yahshua Messiah. So he's pointing to that, okay? Now, these folks could get up here, and I'm just making a long story short, the conquest of Canaan's land, 40 years in the conquest of Canaan's land, Joshua, son of Nun, he led them all, and look, he never got a scratch on his body, all right? For 40 years he led that, okay? So now let's get Joshua, I think it's the 24th chapter. 24, let's start at 1.
Joshua 24 and 1. And Joshua gathered all the tribes of Israel to Shechem, and called for the elders of Israel, and for their heads, and for their judges, and for their officers, and they presented themselves before Elohim. And Joshua said unto all the people, Thus saith Yahweh Elohim of Israel, Your fathers dwelt on the other side of the flood in old time, even Terah, the father of Abraham.
Now hold it right there. It says he dwelt on the other side of the flood. Now most people get confused when they read that statement because they're thinking of the great flood, the great deluge of Noah. That is not the flood it's talking about.
Right.
It says dwelt on the other side of the flood. That's not what it's talking about. It's talking about the river Euphrates. Because what the river Euphrates would do, see, it doesn't look it, but if you check the topography map of the area, you'll see that up this way, there are mountains up here. And the rivers flow this way down into the Persian Gulf. Now, what happens, the rivers would overflow from time to time, and it would bring down all this good silt from the mountains, and it would overflow its banks, and that's why this area was called the Fertile Crescent. See, so Abraham had to cross, see, this river at low levels, you know, otherwise, because had he, you know, if it was flooding over during the time, like in the spring, he wouldn't have been able to cross. So he had to cross over at the low tide, or low time when it's not flooding, to come over in here to come down. But that scripture is misleading, because when people read it and say, well, you know, on the other side of the flood, see, people think about, oh, Noah and the ark. I mean, that's not what it's talking about. See, it's talking about the Euphrates River. Okay? Read it.
Your fathers dwelt on the other side of the flood in old time, even Terah, the father of Abraham, and the father of Nahor, and they served other idols.
And they served idols. Terah, Abraham's father, was a maker of idols. You know, I mean, if you had a store, it would be called Idols R Us. You know, I mean, because whatever you wanted, he could make it. He was just handy like that. Okay, but read.
And I took your father Abraham from the other side of the flood and led him throughout all the land of Canaan and multiplied his seed and gave him Isaac. And I gave unto Isaac Jacob and Esau, and I gave unto Esau Mount Seir to possess it. But Jacob and his children went down into Egypt. I sent Moses also and Aaron, and I plagued Egypt according to that which I did among them.
Now Joshua's standing up here, and he's telling them, and they're thinking that it's talking to Elohim. I'm saying, well, this is what Elohim said. No, they're talking to Elohim himself.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And he's telling them and saying, look, I was the one.
Right.
See, that sent Abraham. I was the one that sent Abraham. I was the one that did all this. See, that's why Joshua could say, you know, Joshua said when he was walking around, said, look, Abraham was glad to see my day. And the scribes and Pharisees said, man, you ain't even 50 years old. And you seen Abraham? I said, yeah, I seen Abraham. When did you see him at? I said, well, back here when I was Joshua's son of Nun, I appeared unto him. I appeared unto him and told him, I said, Abraham, I want you to cross this river and go down into this land I'm going to show you. The same one. See? Read.
And afterward I brought you out.
Mm-hmm. He said, afterwards, I was the one that brought you out. Remember? Because he was that angel in the cloud. And my name is, he was that angel in the cloud. He was the one that divided the Red Sea. He was the one that poured the plagues out on Egypt. He was the death angel himself that went around from door to door to check to see if you had the blood sign. No blood sign? Oh, I'm paying you a visit.
Yeah.
That was him. Read.
And I brought your fathers out of Egypt.
Uh-huh.
And you came unto the sea, and the Egyptians pursued after your fathers with chariots and horsemen into the Red Sea.
Mm-hmm.
And when they cried unto Yahweh, he put darkness between you and the Egyptians,
mm-hmm.
and brought the sea upon them, and covered them, and your eyes have seen what I have done in Egypt.
Mm-hmm.
And you dwelt in the wilderness along Sisa. And I brought you into the land of the Amorites, which dwelt on the other side of Jordan.
Mm-hmm.
And they fought with you, and I gave them into your hand,
mm-hmm.
that you might possess their land, and I destroyed them from before you.
Mm-hmm.
Then Balak, the son of Zippor, king of Moab, arose and warred against Israel, and sent to call Balaam, the son of Beor, to curse you.
Mm-hmm.
But I would not hearken unto Balaam,
mm-hmm.
therefore he blessed you still, so I delivered you out of his hand.
Now, you know, wait a minute, you know who Balaam was? If you ever hear the story, you know, about the ass and
right. Cunt,
that was Balaam. See, you know, when you know he couldn't, you know, he couldn't. That was. I didn't have time, but the angel that appeared unto Balaam, not really, didn't appear unto Balaam first. Appeared unto the animal. The animal saw the angel first and stopped. In fact, the animal had love for her master,
right.
because she saw the angel coming with a sword in his hand and perceived that the angel wanted to kill my master. So she lured. She bolted to the side because she knew what the you know. And even the angel said, "Well, if it wasn't for your donkey, if it wasn't for you, I'd have killed you."
Really?
She loved you enough that she saved you. See, but the thing is, when people see that angel, they think it's Michael or Gabriel. It's not. We just read. Joshua said, I was the one that did. He was the one that appeared to Balaam. How did he do that? He was out here. He astral projected out there to Balaam and dealt with that problem. See, these things can be answered when you take the time to look and understand these scriptures according to a pattern and the purpose of Yahweh. They're like pieces of a puzzle. That's what Dr. Kelly used to say. They're like pieces of a puzzle. And when you understand what the framework is, what the picture is, then you can put the pieces together. See, and Yahweh is that framework. Elohim, the archetype, original pattern of the universe, that is the framework. Okay? Read.
And you went over Jordan and came unto Jericho, and the men of Jericho fought against you. The Amorites and the Perizzites and the Canaanites and the Hittites and the Girgashites and Hivites and the Jebusites, and I delivered them into your hand.
Mm-hmm.
And I sent the hornet before you,
uh-huh.
and drave them out from before you.
The hornet, read.
Even the two kings of the Amorites, but not with thy sword nor with thy bow. And I have given you a land for which you did not labor,
mm-hmm.
and cities which you built not.
Read.
And you dwell in them, of the vineyards and olive yards which you planted, not do you eat. Now therefore fear Yahweh and serve him in sincerity and in truth,
mm-hmm.
and put away the idols which your fathers served on the other side of the flood and in Egypt, and serve ye Yahweh. And if it seem evil unto you to serve Yahweh, choose you this day whom you shall serve, whether the idols which your fathers served that were on the other side of the flood, or the idols of the Amorites in whose land you dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve Yahweh. And the people answered and said, Yahweh forbid that we should forsake him to serve other idols. For Yahweh our Elohim, he it is that brought us up and our fathers out of the land of Egypt, from the house of bondage, and which did these great signs in our sight, and preserved us in all the way where he went, and among all the people to whom he passed.
Okay, that's good enough. Jump down to 29. We need to expedite this.
24:29. And it came to pass after these things that Joshua the son of Nun, the servant of Yahweh, died, being 110 years old.
110 years old. Okay, let's recapitulate here. We got 30 years in Egypt, 40 years in the wilderness, 40 years in Canaan's land, and that comes up to 110 years. All right. How old was Joseph when he died?
110.
See. And remember, and there's a connection, because remember, he said, I was in the place of Elohim.
Right.
And he said, Elohim will surely visit you. That was Joshua. He surely did visit him. And the proof of it was when he crossed his hands and put the blessing on Ephraim. Because when Joshua came, he was attached
right.
to the tribe of Ephraim. Mm-hmm. See? Now, get Acts 1 and 2. Because Joshua's got to fulfill this. See?
Acts 1 and 2, until the day in which he was taken up, after that, he, through the Holy Spirit, had given commandments unto the apostles whom he had chosen,
mm-hmm.
to whom also he showed himself alive after his passion by many infallible proofs, being seen of them 40 days.
40 days.
And speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of Yahweh.
Okay. I'm sorry. Go finish the sentence.
And I did.
Okay. Now, Joshua tarried 40 days after his death, burial, resurrection, then he ascended.
Mm-hmm.
See, the 40 days, that's a fulfillment of the 40 years of Joshua back here. And that would add up, not 110 years, 110 days. But in principle, a day for a year. See, 110 with Joshua, 110 with Joshua.
Mm-hmm.
One is instituting, the other is fulfilling. Okay? Mm-hmm. Now, we read that Moses was 120 years old when he died, right?
Mm-hmm.
Get Leviticus, 23rd chapter. I think it's 23rd chapter, or maybe 25th chapter, maybe that's what I'm thinking.
Leviticus 25 and 8.
Mm-hmm.
And thou should number 7 Sabbath years unto thee. 7 times 7 years,
mm-hmm.
and the space of the seven of years shall be unto thee 49 years. Then thou shalt call the trumpet of jubilee to sound on the 10th day of the 7th month, and in the day of the atonement shall you make the trumpet sound throughout all your land. And ye shall hallow the fiftieth year, and proclaim liberty throughout all the land unto all the inhabitants thereof. It shall be a jubilee unto you, and ye shall return every man unto his possessions, and ye shall return every man unto his family.
Okay, now, this is the law of the jubilee. Okay, now when this law was given, it was given while they were still in the wilderness of Sinai. So this law could not go into effect until they went into Canaan's land and got their inheritance. All right? Now this comes about every 50 years, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Now, when they came into Canaan's land, Joshua died after 40 years of the conquest of Canaan's land and the parceling out of their inheritance. And then 10 years later, after Joshua's death, would be their jubilee,
right?
Right. So, 10 years later, see, that would bring you up to 120. See, 120 years. And see, 120, that would pick Noah up.
Mm-hmm.
See, that would pick Moses up.
Mm-hmm.
See, because Noah preached for 120 years, right?
Right.
Moses lived 120 years.
What? That's correct.
The united monarchy before the division in Canaan's land, Saul, David, and Solomon. See, they each ruled 40 years apiece. 40 times 3 is 120.
Right.
See? Mm-hmm. It picks all that up. Joshua, because he ascended after 40 days, and then 10 days later, See, he poured out the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost. So that's, and how many was in the upper room?
120.
You see that now?
Yeah.
Yahshua, he's picking all these things. That's why it says in the scriptures, you know, Yahshua, he's fulfilling like 4,000 years of people, places, and things in 33 and a half years. I mean, he's just left and right, just picking up, just fulfilling. I mean, it's a mighty work. But I'm showing you here, Joshua, Yahshua, here's the institution, and here's the fulfillment, okay? And Dr. Kinley said that Joshua, that, you know, the fact that Joshua the son of Nun was Joshua the Messiah, it was the greatest mystery that Yahweh ever perpetrated upon man. And let me tell you something, he put it in plain sight, and people still miss it. Don't believe me? Go online and find the Epistle of Barnabas. See, and we'll try to show something here. But while they're doing that, we could just throw some more fuel on this. I think what I want is Hebrews. So Hebrews 4 and 6, I'm thinking. Yeah.
Hebrews 4 and 6.
Start with 7.
Hebrews
4. I meant 7, 4. 4 and 4 and 4.
Hebrews 4 and 4. For he spake in a certain place on the seventh day on this wise, and Elohim did rest the seventh day from all his works. In this place again, if they shall enter into my rest, seeing therefore it remaineth that some must enter therein, and they to whom it was first preached entered not in because of unbelief. Again, he limited a certain day, saying in David, today, after so long a time, as it is said, today, if you will hear his voice, harden not your hearts. For if Yahshua had given them rest, then would he not afterward have spoken of another day?
Let's see now. Read that out of the King James Version.
That is the King James
Version.
Lord Jesus has given them rest.
I know that's the King James Version. I know that. Yeah, so there's in the King James Version, it says, if Jesus had given them rest, then he would not have spoken of another day. Well, what are you talking about? What are you saying? Jesus was back there with them?
Yeah.
See, even the translators, you know, messed that one up. You know, they can see that, but they can't prove or understand how that can be. But Yahshua was back there with them. See, and I hope you can find the Epistle of Barnabas, because that would be great. You got it?
I got it. What part you want?
I want the 12th chapter, 12 and 8. And you can sub out the names if you like. Now this is called the Epistle of Barnabas. These are one of the books that was written by what we call the Apostolic Fathers. These are the people who were taught or had been influenced or were around the apostles when they were alive, and this is like their next generation. Okay? Alright, and so many of them wrote books like Clement, who we can read in the Bible, because he was a student of Paul, and he wrote things. And there were other folks, you know, that you find out about. Like Barnabas here was a companion of Paul. Okay, do you have that over there?
I'm looking for the 12th verse.
The 12th chapter?
Yeah, I'm trying to get it right now.
While he's doing that, let's get, let's see. It's Matthew 16th chapter. And we'll read that while he's getting it, just to throw some more, just to show you, see, that Joshua.
Matthew 16 and 1?
No.
You said, well, you want 12 and?
8.
8. You have it?
Yeah.
Okay. He's got, where are we at?
12.
Just say it.
Why are you?
What?
Never mind. We're
talking. I don't know. Never mind. It was important enough to say. Well, how much time do I have?
12.
12 minutes. Thank you. That's all. You can say it. We're user friendly here. Okay. Now, what Joe has here is the Epistle of Barnabas, which is, you know, one of these extant books of the Bible. Okay. You can go online and find it. And this is what it says here in the book of Barnabas. Okay. Go ahead and read.
What again saith Moses unto Jesus, the son of Nun, parenthesis is Joshua, when he giveth him his name as being a prophet, that all the people might give ear to him alone, because the Father revealed all things concerning his son, Jesus, which is correctly Joshua.
Yeah, read.
Moses therefore said to Jesus, the son of Nun, giving him this name, when he sent him as a spy on the land, take a book in thy hand and write that the Lord saith, how the Son of God shall cut up by the roots all the house of the Amalekites, Amalek of the last days. Behold, again, it is Joshua, not as the son of man, but of the son of God.
Mm-hmm.
And he was revealed in the flesh in a figure. Since then, men will say that Christ is the son of David. David himself prophesied, being afraid and understanding the error of sinners. The Lord said unto my Lord, sit down on my right hand till I set the enemies before a footstool under thy feet. And again,
okay, that's good enough. I think that's about all I need from there. But you heard that part. We're talking about, even Barney said, well, Jesus or Joshua, you know, well, we ain't talking about the Son of Man, but the Son of God.
Right.
Talking about Joshua, that they're one and the same. Mm-hmm. See, and yet that book is nearly 1,800 years old and people still miss it. They just look at it and they don't think much about it. But yeah, it is. There it is right there in print. See? It's right there. You know, somebody says, because people have come to us and say, you people, but I'm saying, but hey, this is one of these other books here, you know.
Is that why they leave that out of the Bible, per se?
Well, I don't know. Well, see, the book overall, if you read it, it's pretty much anti-carnal ordinances. Okay, as a matter of fact, maybe you should go back, I think, read the 10th chapter, Book of Barnabas, if you're still there.
The 10th chapter?
Yeah, let me see what we're doing.
That's 12, if you want 10th chapter. Okay. There it is right there. This is the 11th chapter. Yeah, read this right here. It's 10 and 12. Again, what says Moses to Joshua, the son of Nun, when he gave the name of him as being a prophet that all the people might hear him alone, because the Father did manifest all things concerning his son Joshua, and Joshua, son of Nun, and gave him that name when he sent him to spy out the land of Egypt, the land of Canaan. And he said, take a book in thy hand and write what the Lord saith, for as much as Joshua the son of God shall in the last days cut off by the roots all the house of Amalek. See here again, Jesus, not the son of Joshua, not the son of man, but the son of God, made manifest in a type and in the flesh.
Chapter 9. This will kind of help address your question. Okay, go ahead and read that, Joe.
But why did Moses say, ye should not eat of the swine, neither the eagle, nor the hawk, nor the crow, nor any fish that has not a scale upon him? Answer.
Mm-hmm.
That in the spiritual sense, he comprehends three doctrines that were to be gathered from thence. Besides, which he says to them in the book of Deuteronomy, and I will give my statutes upon this people. Wherefore, it is not the command of God that should not eat these things, but Moses in the Spirit spake of them. Mm-hmm. Now the soul, he forbade him to eat, meaning thus much this, thou should not join thyself to such persons mm-hmm. as are like unto swine, mm-hmm. who while as they live in pleasure, forget their God. But when anyone pinched them, then they know the Lord, and as the sower, when he should full knows his knows not her master, but when she is hungry, she make a noise, and being again fed in silence. Neither say he that shall eat the eagle, nor the hawk, nor the kite, nor the crow, that is thou should not keep company with such kind of men, as know not how by their labor and sweat to give themselves food, but injuriously ravish away the things of others, and watch how to lay snare for them, when at the time, same time they appear to live in perfect innocence. So these birds alone seek not food for themselves, but sitting idle seek how they may eat of the flesh others have provided, being destructors through their wickedness.
Okay, just hold for a minute now. What Barnabas is doing in this book, he's decrying the carnal ordinances. He's trying to show that the carnal ordinances are more than just carnal ordinances, that they're type and shadow of spiritual principles. Okay, now, why this book was not chosen to be put into the rest of the Bible? Well, you'd have to talk to the people who was at the Council of Nicea. Okay, because they were the ones that chose, all right, the books they wanted. Now, some people read that and they think it has a dose of Gnosticism in it. Gnosis, that's spelled G-N-O-S-I-S, you know, the Gnosis. You know, they were people who had some strange ideas about, about the Bible, about God, and so forth and so on. Anyway, what came out of that is that I think, and I'm just making a good guess, a wild guess, I'm trying, that because what Barnabas is saying, that these carnal ordinances, you don't need to do them, and they're just types and shadows of something spiritual. So, and some folks may think that maybe they could take this and apply it to the Roman Catholic doctrine of the Eucharist. See, because there are people that do dispute the divine presence in the Eucharist. You know, whereas the Protestants, they dispute it, because the Protestants will say, well, it's a type, it's a symbolic thing. Okay, whereas the Roman Catholics say, no, this is, you know, this is the actual body and blood of Jesus Christ, you know, gluten free. Okay, so, and that's what I'm going to say. I would love to get into that. But yeah, like I say, because if it was put into the Bible, then more people would read it, and then they would probably question it more, question the doctrines of men a lot more, saying, well, wait, well, the book of Barnabas says, so, you know, so they just say, well, no, let's put that to the side.
Yeah, I know, arbitrary things.
Yeah, so that's my best guess on that. I mean, you know, I'm just, you know.
There's other books of the Bible also.
Yeah. Oh, there's many, not just for so-called New Testament times. There's books purporting, you know, Old Testament stuff. There's books that supposedly Enoch wrote, which he didn't. Okay, but I'm just saying, you know, you can go online and find them. Okay, most are spurious. A couple are not. This is not spurious, in my opinion, because what it says in there. Now, some people will read and say, "Oh, that's a bunch of baloney," but we know that it's true, and we can prove that it's true about Joshua, son of Nun, or what it says in there about that. Yeah, that's why I brought that out, that it was really hidden in plain sight. It's been in that book for thousands of years. But Dr. Kinley said it's the greatest mystery Yahweh ever perpetrated on man. And yet here it is right there in a book, in plain sight, a book that's 1900 years old. Yeah. Hidden in plain sight. See? We're out of time.
I have a question. Why did Moses have to lay his hands on Joshua when Joshua didn't need it?
Lay his hand on for what?
It said that he laid his hand on him.
Okay.
So that
it was for the people, because he's passing on the leadership to him. So it was for the people, so the people could see.
Oh, I see.
You know, he's passing on the leadership, you know, because he had already said, Yahweh will raise up among you. You know, one like unto myself, you know, amongst thy brethren, you know, him you will follow. And he pointed him out.
So he really didn't need it, he was just doing it.
Well, no, but Joshua was his minister.
That's what I'm saying.
Okay, see, there's a lot of other things we could go into, but we're out of time, see. See, we go up in here where Joshua here went up here, he transfigured for Peter, James, and John, and then came back and said, tell this to no man, till the Son of Man be risen again from the dead. And we could go back in Judges and show you what Joshua did rise from the dead and came back and told him and asked him and said, say, wait a minute. Didn't I tell you to tear these idols down? And he got about the grave and, you know. It's a lot of things we could talk about. But I hope that something was said that would stir your mind and that maybe you would take the time and look and research and consider and remember. These things, our founder said this. Take the time to scrutinize this vision. Because in scrutinizing this vision, you'll see how it's all interconnected, like pieces of a puzzle. And the more you do it, the more easier it will become. As he would say, it gets brighter and brighter. And you'll just see more. And when we come together, then you can bring the part Yahweh has shown you, and I bring my part. And it's all one vision when you really do it right. It's all. It's not a thing like, well, I got a thing to say. Oh, no, I got something. No. It's all one because all the prophets, when they prophesied, they had their part. They were given. Isaiah had his part. Jeremiah had his part. Obadiah had his part. They all had their part. But when you put it all together, see, it just comes out, and it's perfect. And with those few words, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Brother, truly thank the Father for our whole class this morning. We hold classes every Tuesday or Friday from 7:30 to 9:30. Sunday mornings from 11 to 1. Fourth Sunday of every month, we have a Spanish class from 9:30 to 10:45, which will be next Sunday. And all donations will be accepted by our treasurer, Dr. Lori Lawless. If you want a copy of today's lecture, please see Kennaway after class. So come back again and study with us. Bring your friends and all your enemies and stand for the doxology. Now to him that is able to keep you from falling and present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign. Belong glory, majesty, dominion, and power both before all time, now and ever. Let us all say,
Hallelujah.
Ray Thompson.
Oh, hi, Ray Thompson.
Oh, no name.
Hey, little girl.
What you doing here?
Yeah.
I think Rex.
I don't know that. She looked like a daddy. Got daddy bad.
Daddy bad.
I was
one. Oh, you didn't get it?
Which one's the first one? The first one's the second.
You were helping to teach today, huh?
There was one.
You were standing up there, ready to go.
Copying everybody.
For him and you. You know what happened to the other DVD that was here for you?
She wanted that stick. That's what she wanted.
I had one.
You want to try it?
Yeah.
I left more here.
Bye.
See you.
Nice. Where's my guys?
All right.